The CT scans of Tutankhamun's feet contain an often overlooked detail which might explain how Tut could have been an active hunter while suffering from a crippling disease. Dr. Ashraf has brought the scans to Zahi's office to show him the results.
Okay, now we have here the CTs of the feet, and you can see that the acquired disease is this tiny little piece of bone. Some people call it Freiberg's disease. This happens when the blood supply is diminished to this area. So this piece of bone becomes dead.
Thing is, Freiberg's disease creeps up on you.
Usually this is a teenager.
A teenager?
Disease, ah. Yes. Maybe 12 or 13 years up to 19 years. Sometimes it's great pain. He couldn't do anything, even walking on his foot.
So it's possible that a few years after he ascended to the throne, the young King Tut began to suffer excruciating pain in his left foot, around about the point where he took the decision to abandon the religion of his father. For Tut, it might even have seemed to work, because according to Dr. Ashraf's timeline, his foot probably stopped hurting soon after he abandoned the art.
This is a self-limiting disease, meaning it takes maybe 1 or 2 years till it becomes pain-free and where that he can walk again on this foot. But before that, he couldn't walk properly.
But only a few years later, he was dead. The state of Tutankhamun's mummy has prompted many exotic theories about how he died.
First of all, there appeared to be a patch at the back of the skull, which seemed consistent with him having had a blow to the back of the head.
And there are all these theories about the fact that he was murdered or that he had been killed in battle.
The whole front of the chest of the mummy, including the heart, was missing, which led to various theories that he might have died from some kind of crushing injury to the chest, gored by hippopotamus, kicked by a horse, run over by a chariot. A whole range of possibilities have been put in the literature.
But the examination of Tut's mummy by Zahi's team provides evidence that many of these theories have another explanation. One born from Howard Carter's problems extracting the mummy from the tomb in the first place. When Carter opened up the burial chamber, he discovered that the body of Tutankhamun was encased in 3 magnificent golden coffins, sealed within the sarcophagus at its center.
Each one was inside the other one, and therefore he had to do the pulleys and take one coffin by one coffin. These photographs that we see of Howard Carter taking the 3 coffins out show how hard work it was for him to open the burial chamber. It was really a difficult job. It was not easy.
The whole process of going from opening the sarcophagus until actually getting to the mummy is something like 2 years, although a part of that is taken up with his dealings with the courts.
Because in 1924, Howard Carter got locked out of the tomb.
The trouble was that, say, Carter had always been a prickly individual, and this culminated with a major falling out with the Egyptian authorities. It was over something quite minor, but there was a major blow-up, and he effectively decided to close the tomb and say, just get on with it, I've had it.
Carter walked out of the tomb, leaving the coffin still hanging above the sarcophagus.
This was February 1924, and after that, he went to the States to give lectures.
I think that that Carter's rather rash flouncing away from the tomb played into the hands of those who were against him.
The authorities locked him out of the tomb, and Carter spent a year embroiled in suit and countersuit with the Egyptian government. He was not allowed back into the tomb until January 1925. And it wasn't until October that he was ready to lift the lid on Tutankhamun's final coffin.
When he opens the innermost coffin, what he finds in front of him is a black mass relieved by a brilliant golden mask.
Now, Howard Carter tried to take the mask out. He couldn't. Because when the Egyptian buried King Tut quickly, they put in the resin, and the resin made the mask stuck to the mummy.
So they had to be fairly brutal, shall we say, about removing it, including cutting the body in half across the thorax, and then gradually removing the body piecemeal, effectively.
And he damaged the mummy to 18 pieces.
I don't think Carter had any other option. It was either leave the mummy exactly where it was, or pull the wrappings off and then leave the whole thing stuck in, or take the drastic approach.
Now, me as an archaeologist, I imagined myself as Howard Carter, and I found this mask. Am I going to leave the mask on the mummy, or I will do what Howard Carter did? Honestly, I will do what Howard Carter did.
The damage done to the mummy by Carter and later examinations in the 1960s led many to believe that Tutankhamun had been murdered. But the CT scans from Zahi's team paint a very different picture.
They could see a loose bone inside the skull. So they assumed that this was the cause of his death, murdered by a blow to the head, and a depressed bone just get inside the skull.
Is it true?
No, on the contrary. Because this piece of bone came when they tried to remove the golden mask, they broke it, and this piece of bone just got inside the skull because of what Carter did to the mummy, not before he died. Because if this piece of bone was there before embalming or before mummification, it would have been stuck to the resin inside the skull.
Can we say, now we are sure that Tutankhamun was not murdered?
Yes.
But in that case, how did Tutankhamun die? In their studies of Tut's mummy, Zahi's team believe they found the answer in a compound fracture above his left knee.
What made this fracture peculiar is that we noticed two things. There was a big wound at the site of the fracture, so that when they did the mummification process, the resin is liquid, went inside the wound and get into the edges of the bone. All the other fractures were induced by Howard Carter.
The wound seems to have got infected.
He might have developed infection that reached the blood. We call it septicemia. And septicemia might be one of the causes of his death.
On its own, Tut might have survived this. But that was not all. During their studies, Zahi's team discovered the markers for a virulent disease lurking in Tut's body.
He had malaria. In the presence of high inbreeding and malaria and weak health, it might predispose him to infection that can kill him with septicemia, as you said.
So after all the exotic theories, the simple mundane truth is that Tutankhamun most probably died of malaria, complicated by blood poisoning, after fracturing his leg from a fall. But the question Zahi wants to answer is, how did he fall?
Is it possible that Tutankhamun had an accident? Maybe he was riding a chariot?
Of course, any type of accident might be the cause, of course. Now, it has to be a speed because of the big wound. So if he is riding a chariot, this makes more sense than just falling down on the ground.
Though impossible to prove, Zahi would like to believe that the young King Tut died trying to show he could ride a chariot once again.
I really think that he was riding a chariot in the desert of Memphis. I'm sure that he died in an accident in the Valley of Gazelle.